Afternoon, everybody. Welcome to episode 36 of the Year of the Anthem podcast. This week, we're talking about Corey's new idea for a project. You get to be inside the creative mind of Corey Baker. And we talk about Serial. The final episode's coming up this week, and we talk about the tour I took around the city of Baltimore to all the sites. So all that and more coming up right now on the Year of the Anthem podcast.
I learned at a Ravens bar in San Francisco. One, two, three, tuck you. This is Corey, and this is the Year of the Anthem podcast.
Good afternoon, everybody. It's Rob.
I like that one a lot.
That was interesting, yeah.
No, because, like, every single time Tucker did something,
right.
Field goal, touchback. Yeah, it was just, like, one guy leading the charge. He's like, one, two, three, and the whole bar at the same time. He's like, tuck you.
It's like those guys
down on the field. You know it's the perfect level of inappropriate yet funny.
Right.
If my dad was sitting there first laughing the first like four times they did it,
right.
And then getting in on the fun.
Right.
My dad's not usually the type to find
It's like those
explicit language that funny, but
the fans that aren't on the field but have the field side seats.
Yeah.
Who wear the gloves in the front of your section.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. Like, hey, it's not your job, but it's your job now.
Well, what I especially like about those guys I was at a Ravens game, I don't know when, at some point, because I go to every game, and I sit right behind them.
Yeah.
However many rows
in
up.
In front of them. Yeah, well, they're in front of you, between you and the field.
Right.
Yeah.
But they're, like, directly in front, like, if I just look down the section.
Yeah.
I see them. And somebody said, why is everybody off with the scoreboard? Because the scoreboard does the thing where, like, a truck pulls chains.
Yeah, yeah. By the way,
move those
shameless
chains.
Advertising, because it stops for a split second and says, Ford F-150,
yeah.
And then it moves through. Like, you bastard.
Like, it does the Matrix slowdown, like, where it's, like, fast action, and then it's
right.
Just like,
Ford F-150, move those chains.
I'm going to have to get a picture of it for your video tomorrow.
Yeah.
When I go see the Ravens hopefully beat the Jaguars, please, for the love of God. Please, for the love of God, don't lose to the Jaguars.
Well, my fantasy hopes are high on that one, so.
Do you have a lot of Jaguars on your team?
No, but Shaney's got a couple of Ravens and Jaguars I would like to all to do poorly.
Oh, okay. So maybe we win by three.
That's all I ask. I don't have to cheer against my team.
Three to nothing.
Although, wait, does she have no, Chelsea has Tucker.
Yeah.
All right, so I'm fine then, yeah.
Yeah.
Justin Tucker kicks one field goal. One, two, three, tuck you!
Yeah. No, but the person was asking, like, why don't we just follow the scoreboard with
right.
the move that Shane's is like, that he, whoever looked like really sternly at her, he's like, we listen to the guys with the gloves.
Yes, we do.
They're the authority figure here.
They
lead the charge. They know what they're talking about.
It's disconcerting, though, because they do their own thing.
Yeah.
They don't care when the music
goes. Well, yeah, that's another bit of it. Like,
yeah.
Because they, sometimes, like, you really just, like, it's exciting, like, Torrey Smith with a 40-yard pass play for our first down. And everyone's going crazy. We're all got our hands in the air doing jazz hands, like,
yeah.
Waiting for it. And sometimes they like to do, like, the little, like, pump fake. Like, they go to the right a little bit or something like that. They're like, ha-ha, gotcha. Just, like, fucking move those chains already. It's first down.
They've already thrown the ball
on
first down.
They're in the huddle for the next. Do you want us to be screaming all simultaneously? 70,000 people screaming, move those chains while they're trying to communicate with one another? Let's just do this thing.
Have we learned no lesson from Seattle? You hear a pin drop. Once Russell Wilson hits hits the huddle, you can hear a pin drop. It's always disconcerting to listen to a Seattle game at home, an Indy game at home. It used to be a Vikings game at home, but now they're at the outdoor
University
stadium.
Of Minnesota.
Yeah. But where, like, when the defense is on the field, you can't hear anything.
Yeah.
But I can hear Peyton. I can hear Andrew Luck, like, in the huddle, and
yeah.
I'm like, that place is quiet.
Yeah. It always just gets me, too, like, watching, I'm not, like, a super huge football fan.
What?
Oh, I'm not a super huge football fan in the sense that, like, if I'm just, like, tooling around, I'll just watch any game.
Really?
Really. I mean, I'll keep it on, and I'll walk through, and I'll be like, oh, the Vikings are winning.
Right,
whatever.
Yeah. But you're not
going
to sit.
Yeah, I'm not sitting there going, like, man, I really got a lot of money riding this. Anything like that.
That sounds more like a gambling problem and less like a football fan.
But I don't like, watch Monday Night Football on any regularity or anything like that.
Oh, I do. Just, I do. When you send me the podcast super late, and it's 9 o'clock at night on a Monday, and I'm done.
Speaking of which, we should probably touch on that, because... I got a bone to pick with you, Google Drive.
Okay, I was going to say, it better not be with me.
No.
It's fucking Google Drive's problem.
No. I would like to say that under normal circumstances, I feel like it wouldn't have been that late.
No.
So here's what happens. I put together the audio file. I mix it and put the O at the beginning and all that sort of stuff.
A little behind the scenes for the people.
Yeah. And then I send it to Rob, and he puts together all the images for the video.
Right.
And then... if you've been watching the video the last couple of weeks, you might have noticed all the fancy stuff in the beginning, like the little intro.
Right, yeah.
All the legal stuff, regular O the Anthem drop, and then, like, our football montage where we, like, turn and face the camera right. with the...
If you're not watching the video, you should be, because you're missing out on the bonus.
For the very least, look at that part. Just watch the first minute of the podcast on the video. And then if you like what Rob throws out there, just keep... You know,
Hell yeah.
I feel like it's a nice screensaver. It's like the Chromecast screensaver.
Right.
Sometimes I just like
to
look up and...
Sometimes there's an image of a bag of dicks.
Yeah.
So that happens.
Like an actual bag of dicks.
Yeah. It's nothing ever is pornographic, but occasionally it's a cartoon drawing of a paper bag full of dicks.
Or every once in a while you see people in cat singlets talking about Derek Jeter.
Yes. But
I hope that's still in the podcast regular.
It is.
Yeah, good.
But generally speaking, it's you know, it's pretty calm. And I have people who say, oh, yeah, I just turn it on, I full screen YouTube, and then I sit there and I do what I'm doing at work or wherever and have it playing. And then when something happens, I look up, I see a picture of
whatever's being discussed.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The cat singlet. Derek Jeter's the man.
Yeah. It's kind of – I was just remarking to you before we started rolling that I'm going to – with the Terps basketball being really good this year.
Right.
Nationally ranked. It's very upsetting to me that we're not in the ACC anymore.
Now, why is that? Because you're not playing Duke and North Carolina.
Yeah, I spent all my life hating Duke and North Carolina and, right. you know, the other schools to a secondary degree, you know. I don't really hate Wake Forest, but, like, if Wake Forest is playing Maryland, then I hate Wake right. Forest very much.
Because,
like, I don't really hate the Tampa Bay Rays, but if they're playing the Orioles, then they're stupid and their fans are dumb and they never come to the stadium, even though it's literally across the bridge that's smaller than the Bay Bridge.
Yeah. But you can't hate Nebraska or
Michigan or Ohio State. I mean, yeah. Over time, I'll learn to hate them, but, like, for the meantime, like, it's new to me. Like, I never had to hate Michigan before.
Yeah. You know, I'll use the example I used when describing.
In fact, if I ever watched like a Michigan Ohio State game, I'd pull for Michigan.
Why?
Because I like Michigan more than Ohio State.
Just the outfits, or
I just like Michigan more.
Oh.
I would rather live in Michigan than Ohio, given my druthers.
And given that we traveled through both just a few,
right?
Oh God, like 2 months ago. Nonetheless,
I don't think there's much excitement in Ohio.
Maybe, but no, it's a gradual.
At least in Detroit, you can run from somebody trying to shoot you. That feels like home to me.
It's a gradual build.
Yeah.
And I'll say like, the same example I used earlier. It wasn't like in Nazi Germany, they said, oh, hey, buddy, how you doing, my friend who's a Jew? Boom, camps.
Yeah.
No. It's a slow burn.
Boom, camps.
Boom, we're all in camps. No. It's a slow burn, and you have to build the hatred. So
right.
What I'm saying is that for you college football and basketball fans, you're like Nazis. That's what I'm saying.
Oh, okay. Well,
shots fired. Right there. That
shots
was it.
Fired.
Go ahead. Yeah. Twitter at Robert Achie.
I don't care that much about college sports.
I'm trying to build a cloud squash.
But I like the...
I want 40,000 people tweeting at me. Hey, this fucking prick. He compared basketball fans to Nazis. Let's go.
As a fan of the University of Nebraska, I feel offended by this.
Nobody in Nebraska gets that fired up about anything.
Nobody in Nebraska has the internet.
I want to apologize too because I feel like I'm breathing really heavy in the mic. I'm trying to turn my head, but I'm so freaking congested. I'm like,
that's a great sound effect, by the way.
Yeah, yeah.
That was natural too. There was no
just me breathing.
No post production work done on that bit. Rob and I both have an allergy to cats.
Yes.
Rob to a much higher degree than I do.
Well, we were talking about that. Like, you can't touch the cats.
Right. If I touch them and then like touch my face or any, like, I just burst out into like itch.
Right.
It's not like hives, but it's like just like a horrible itch.
You know, I don't get that.
But like it, and if the, so if a, there was a cat that was sleeping in my presence at one point.
Right.
And in the middle of the night, I choked on vomit.
Oh yeah.
Like
that's right.
that's how bad it can be.
Yeah.
Like it swelled my throat shut and then I couldn't breathe and then I started choking.
Which happens to me. If I sleep in a bed that a cat was sleeping in, I would not wake up in the morning.
Right.
Yeah, but if I touch them, I'm fine. I don't get itchy on the skin. It's all just upper respiratory.
And it's not like immediate itching either. Like, right. If I ever touch a cat, I just immediately wash my hands thoroughly.
Right.
And I'm okay.
Why would you... I mean, oh, so you, when you grab it to throw it off the bridge, or...
Right, like when I grab it by the tail and I throw it into oncoming traffic.
When you drop kick it into the pool? Yeah.
Jack Black in the original Aggerman, where he's like, well, now this is happening. He kicks the dog. No! Baxter!
I'm in the last case of emotion.
And mine went to the same place.
Oh, but yeah, no. So you get itchy, I get all like verklempt.
Yeah.
I've been having trouble breathing. I had allergies anyway, and now I got exposed to a cat. Now I have even more trouble breathing.
Yeah.
So I feel like I'm like labored breathing into the mic.
It's all right.
So I'm going to try to.
We'll forgive you. Just this time, though.
It's likely to happen again. Likely to happen pretty often, so.
I would like to throw out throw out something nice here.
Sure, yeah.
I was perusing OkCupid recently.
Uh-huh.
And I sent a message to a girl who I thought was neat. And, well, no, I'm not trying to, I don't know anything about her at this point. I know what she's written. I know what, right. I know you what, like, her pictures look like.
You like dead ass or... No, because you're a profile reader. You're a reader.
Not only that, but OkCupid just goes into my, like, horrible statistical, like, part of my brain.
Right.
Where, like, I read answers to questions.
Yeah.
And I'm just like, she thinks smoking's disgusting. I don't know if this is going to work.
Right. Like, smokers and cat haters to the left.
Yeah.
And left.
But I sent her a message, and basically, you know, like, I'm not trying to put out everything about this situation, but right. You know, it was basically like, hey, I find you neat. I think we'd get along nice, and
I think I spotted your problem.
I'd like to. I think you're super keen, and
you're the bee's knees.
You are, in fact. Would you like to go out with me at some point and get malted?
I was thinking maybe the drive-in. Go to the sock hop after.
Go to the drive-in. Go to Benji's and just pull the, like, ooh! Punch the roof of my car.
Whoops.
And then it blows up. Punch a hole directly through the roof of my car.
Yeah.
Like, fuck you, the reliable Subaru and reliability.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah. Right. Anyway. Anyway, I sent a message.
You said she was neat.
I sent a message to her, said she was keen.
Yeah.
I enjoyed her her poodle skirt and such.
Right.
And waited for the reply.
As you do.
As anybody who's ever done this before knows, like, there's no, like, you send the message, and then you're just like, all right, well, fuck that, bitch. Like,
actually, that is, like, my policy. Well, I like to be pleasantly surprised by people.
Yeah.
I'm like, oh, so she wasn't a huge cunt. All right, good.
Right. But, like, yeah, so, you know, just sent it off there and then patiently waited for the reply.
And by that, you mean you stood with your phone shaking your hands. Come on.
Refresh, refresh. Pulling down on my email, just open for an... Come on! Gmail down again?
Like, by the way, that is the modern version of the, I don't know if you ever did this, sitting by the phone and then just picking it up to make sure.
Making sure it still works.
Looking for the ringtone? Okay. Yeah. I hope she didn't call. I hope she didn't try to call when I did that. Oh, I don't have call waiting.
Well, I'm only going to try and call him once right now. It's busy. He's probably fucking some other bitch. He did talk about in freshman year how he had a girlfriend in Canada.
Yes.
Maybe he's getting back with his Canadian girlfriend.
Because that is how your crazy ass minds work. You sent me that picture on Facebook of girlfriend calling the guy, yeah, and then what she thinks, and he's making out with some other girl, and what's really happening, they're sitting on the floor with helmets on.
Yeah, it's like behind like a car fender. It's like him and the dog playing a video game. I love that image. That was a really good one.
I gotta say, I want to make another one where it's just me in some sloppy position hanging off my couch, snoring away. Because 9 times out of 10, if I don't pick up, it's because I've sat in
my sponsor. Version of that would probably be sleeping.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because more than likely I'm sleeping. Or my phone with the horrible battery life is, like, charging in the other room, and I'm here, like, click-clacking away on the keys.
And you hear it, and you're like, fuck
that. I'll be like, eventually I'll get that. And then 9 hours later, I'm just like, oh, yeah, that's right, the phone rang. I wonder if Rob doesn't mind me calling him at 3 a.m. But anyway, I sent her the message and then sat there and compulsively refreshed my phone, hoping that turning thing on and off.
Here's the thing, though, as an aside.
Yeah.
You couldn't do that because 9 times out of 10, you get nothing.
Right.
Just static.
Yeah. But anywho, I got a message back.
Right.
In a pretty quick amount of time.
Right.
I want to say it was like 20, 30 minutes, something like that.
Okay.
I was just like, yes. All right. Let's do this.
By the way, though, automatic good sign. If you get the message back, that means she's interested.
Yeah.
Because you don't hear back.
Right.
Except.
Yeah. I hate if you send a message out to somebody and then all of a sudden you go to like their profile like 3 days later and it's just like online earlier today at 10 a.m. And you're just like,
I messaged you
4 days ago.
You bitch.
You hate me. I'm going to eat everything.
I have my cute skinny pictures on there. Not even that was good enough. Not even the cute skinny pictures are good enough.
I feel like I should just make one OkCupid picture. Just like me with like the belly hanging out. Like eating ice cream out of the... eating a whole pint of ice cream just like to myself.
Don't turn me into this.
Hair all akimbo and...
Don't turn me into this.
Yeah.
Please respond to my messages.
This is me. This is me alone.
I'm a mess.
But yeah, I got a message back right away.
Right.
And then I was just like, oh, game's on.
Right.
Like, soup's on. And I went, checked the message, and it was a very polite no.
Okay.
But I would like to say big ups on this girl because... she had the common courtesy to say, like, you know, hey, I don't think me and you are really going to make anything happen here. So, good luck to you. But this is a respectful no.
Right.
Then I sent her a message back just saying, like, you know what? That was really classy. I appreciate you sending me that message.
And it is. Said, stop calling me psycho. It's not going
to
happen.
It's not going to happen. I said it. I'd be like, I wasn't trying to do anything. All right. You want to come over and fuck? Well... all right.
And we're there. My new game has been realized. Now for the rest of your life.
I just like guys who are persistent.
Now for the rest of your life, you're going to be trying that because it worked one time.
Just like that theory I have about that one guy who like walks around the bar and just every woman just like, hey, nice tits, baby.
Yeah.
Hey, how about you put them tits in my face?
It worked one time.
Yeah, one super drunk, desperate girl did it, and now he feels like he has a license to do it all the time.
Exactly. Yeah, but no, so... you sent the message back and said, hey, very polite, thank you.
Yeah.
And
nothing since then, which I expected.
Right, but so here,
it was a polite, like, hey, no thanks.
My thing about it is, if we were in public and not on the internet, that is what would happen every time.
Exact point I was trying to make.
Yeah.
Like, I feel like, my dad especially does this. Like, if I get more than 2 texts in 30 seconds, he's just like, who's trying to reach you? Why do they always have to be doing this?
Right.
Like, God forbid if it goes off, like, consistently throughout the entire time I'm spending with him, he's just like, who the hell needs to talk to you?
You mean, like, if a dead drop gets back up and drops all the time?
Just, like, retweeting.
Yeah.
But I've always thought of any kind of communication, any kind of electronic communication, as, like, somebody walking up to the street. Like, I'm walking down a sidewalk, and somebody else is walking down the opposite side of the sidewalk. And they're like, hey. And if I just ignore your text message.
Yeah.
Then it's the version of me, like, just, like, looking at you. You say, hey, and then I walk away.
It's the homeless guy who's like, you got a quarter? Ignore him, like, pretend he's not there.
Keep walking.
Yeah.
But, like, you know, obviously there's exceptions. Like, there's a lot of times where somebody sends me a text and I don't necessarily see it. Right. Where, like, the notification gets lost, and that gets lost, and I don't notice that you texted me for days.
Another great reason not to have an iPhone, because you don't have that message read receipt.
Yeah.
Oh, that's the worst thing in the world.
Right. Because yeah. Then you actually have to, like, respond to it.
Yeah, I opened it, and I'm like, shit, God, now I gotta respond to this bullshit.
But, yeah, that's...
So, very nice. So, hey, bitches, start doing that. How about that?
I feel like it's... such a reasonable thing.
Common courtesy.
Just if it's just like at the bar. Like if I walked up to some girl at the bar, like the old school method of having to approach people in person. Right. Like if I
now, do you scream, "Hey, nice tits, let's fuck" in her face?
Well, I do it in the voice. I do the, "Hey, baby, nice tits, and you want fuck."
Right.
Yeah.
Okay. The little half dance you do.
It's the walk.
We need a video.
It's like what's his face? It's like Ric Flair walking to the ring.
Yeah, that's what it is.
Woo!
Yeah.
No, but like in person, if I walk up to a girl, I'm like, "Hey, you're kind of cute. You want a drink?" I wouldn't say that. I'm just giving an example of the fast forward version of this.
Right.
Then, you know, nobody would just like look at you and walk away, because then you're just a colossal bitch.
Yeah.
But like if you looked at me and you're just like, I don't think this is, I'm not interested. Just be like, all right. Fine enough.
Thank you.
There are things I'm not interested in as well.
Yes. Now you are on that list. I'm just kidding. I love you.
Immediately included.
I love you. Can we still go out? I'm sorry.
Can we just be friends? Can we just be friends? I'm going to make a really awkward pass at you at some point. Like, we'll hang out. We're watching West Wing.
Right.
And then I'm like, "Hey, you want to cuddle?" What? You want to cuddle?
No.
No. That's weird. We're friends. Oh, okay.
See, I don't get that. I don't have that reaction from people, but that's because
probably because you're just, like, getting up and, you know, "All right, well, I'm going to go fuck. You want to join?"
Okay, so that has happened. Did we talk about that last week? I feel like we did. Anyway, no, just me.
I think we just talked about it in generalities off the podcast.
But, oh, well, you know, no, people will come over and hang out. We're just sitting and watching TV, and then I'll be like, "All right, time for bed. So are we going to do this thing or what?" And then we go, and then she leaves. It's like the best thing in the world.
Yeah.
But you are looking for love. So.
Lucky you. Most nights I'm spending with Claudia Jean Craig, so.
Well, I do that too. But there's also somebody there.
Right.
This could be you. Corey. This could be your life.
It could Ba-da-da-da. Be. Well, so I'm going to segue this into, okay. I came up with a movie idea today.
Yeah.
And the character has a writer-director guy who to do the segue here, which is already fucking horrible because I'm explaining it.
Now you're
it.
Explaining the segue. Now yeah.
It's like the
it's a good pod.
Olivia Munn, Sam Watterson moment from the newsroom where it's like, "How long do I have to come up with a comeback?" Right then. The first words that came out of your mouth were the comeback. You lost the ability to make the comeback.
Yes.
Anywho. In said idea that I'm working on, the writer-director has a trophy wife.
Right.
Who's, like, interested in, like, becoming, like, a reality TV star or an auto-tune pop star or something like that. So,
a Kardashian, if you will.
Right. Or Megan Trainor or something like
First
that.
First of all, totally different.
First of all, I don't give a shit. If you're using autotune, then you're either lazy, stupid, can't sing, or you're the puppet of a massive label.
Okay.
So all four of those eliminate you from being an interesting singer.
Okay. I'll just lay it lay. That's a different issue. Go ahead.
Or a singer at all. But I like to think that, when we fast forward through my life, it's either going to be I'm with somebody who's, like, super funny and always makes me laugh.
Right.
Or I'm with, an artist who I fight with constantly.
Okay.
Or I'm with, some sort of trophy wife who hates me.
I'll take door number three, Alex. Right now, if possible.
I think those are, like, the three...
Yeah,
the three forks.
Yeah.
That's basically.
Anyway.
Yeah. So in this story, there's a trophy wife, dumb trophy wife.
And why does she have to be dumb? Because she's cute. She has to be dumb.
I just assume that part of being a trophy wife is being dumb, but
I don't think that that's necessarily true.
Well, you would want somebody who's dumber than you.
Well, for me, that's everybody, though, so I guess.
Well, not everybody.
Yeah.
Everybody that you're trying to go out with, or?
Every person in this room.
Oh, well, sir.
Plus, I mean, other people.
I was going to say, if we're talking about a relationship between the two of us.
Oh, God.
It's not going to take me very long.
First of all, you have gamed the statistics, and that's what I'm going to say. You've gamed the statistics. Doesn't matter.
Just keep talking, because I'm typing, and I can't do two things at the same time.
So, as you might remember, there was a poll done based on last week's episode about which one of us would be the submissive one in a relationship. Corey has gamed the poll in his favor, although I will be super ecstatic if he pulls this up, and it's the opposite of the last time I looked at it. Good job not knowing your password, jerk. So basically, here's the thing. Corey knows that he would be the submissive, and he's looking for a validation that he's not, in fact, the submissive by going to create a post and then having.
Who's the bottom? We have 35 votes so far.
Yep.
And it is 30-5 in Rob's favor. Rob,
how many times have you voted in this poll?
Twice.
Okay.
I voted twice.
I didn't vote at all.
The first time I voted was just to put my vote out there.
Right.
The second time was to check the current results, which I don't feel is an unfair vote.
I do.
If you want to make it just 29-5,
yeah,
then I'm fine with that as well. But I'm still beating you by a pretty respectable margin.
Here's what I'll say about that. There is a lot of bitter bitches out there that I think are voting on this in an effort to make themselves feel better.
So you think it's the women?
I am 90% sure it's the women. Because every person I've talked to has said, oh, Corey would totally be the bottom. And we were talking about that.
I think they're saying it to you to make you feel better. Because they're talking to you.
I don't know.
If the same person talked to me, they'd be like, by the way, you're totally the top. Rob's totally the bottom.
I don't think that's
the way it goes.
I don't think that's true. Anyway. So, trophy wife, let's get into your story.
He's totally the bottom, but I know he can't handle it.
Let's get into the story.
Yeah. So, what I thought we would do right here, right now, is this podcast is meant to be
the
sort
graphic
of
retelling. Let's do it. We're gonna read some lines. Table read.
No, I don't have anything written yet.
Not yet. What?
No. Okay. I was watching West Wing since work. Jesus Christ! I need to relax sometimes.
No, you don't. I don't relax unless I'm sleeping off a drug-infused haze. And by drug-infused, I mean allergy medicine that makes me pass out.
Yeah, I do a lot of those too.
Bullshit. You do a lot of chicken related.
Do a lot of fried chicken related sleeps.
Yes.
Wake up in the morning with bones all over the bed.
I don't know what happened. I need a nap.
Just a segue for any of the women out there who heard about my okay Cupid messaging and are now having ulterior motives. I will say that I'm a lot like Aiden from the Sex and the City.
Okay.
But particularly the moment where she went out for a fancy evening and he stayed home and ate chicken.
Right.
And then when she comes home trying to have sex, he's just like, can you rub my belly? I'm full of chicken.
So you said Aiden, I thought you were going Adnan for a minute.
No, we'll get into that, though.
Cereal. All right, anyway, so your story is what? So, trophy wife.
So, did we have this conversation in earnest when I came down to pick up my car?
What's that?
About my writing style and how much you hate me.
We talked about it on the podcast last week.
We did too. I lose track of our conversations from time to time.
What's been recorded and what's not been recorded?
Right.
Yeah, no, that you're a huge hack. That part was not on the podcast.
Okay, so here's how I write. I think I might have said this part specifically before, but I sit down, I write about 14 pages or so, 15 pages. I go upstairs, I chain smoke like 5 cigarettes. I come back down, I read them, I hate them, and then I delete them all and start over.
Right.
And I do this over and over and over again until I get 14 or 15 pages that I like.
After a few hours.
After many, many hours.
Yes.
And I may throw away 100 pages.
To get 14.
Yeah. But I don't like to have evidence of my horrible writing available for people to read.
So you don't save it.
So I don't save it.
Right.
And Rob hates this.
I do.
Because he thinks I'm I don't know, like, not utilizing the skill that I have of writing 100 pages.
No, because version 1 and version 100 are so similar that it makes no sense.
You've never seen version 1.
I know, but I can extrapolate that you are probably rewriting the same thing more than once. You're writing that version 100 has a little bit from 1, a little bit from 20, and a little bit from 55, but it's essentially the same thing over and over again. You don't know that because you delete it and then rewrite it. If you just left it, you would know that and do the version count the way that I do, and everything would be better in the world.
Well, here's what I was driving around, and I was thinking about it this morning, and I said, I wonder if I could write something that has a single draft. Like, the first crack at it is what I shoot.
Right.
Essentially. And that started getting me into this thought of where my fears of, like, a first draft being found and everyone saying, like, oh, well, Corey can't write.
He's a horrible hack.
Yeah, he's a horrible hack.
Yeah.
I can't believe we ever trusted him. All that sort of stuff. So, what I came up with was an idea for a short, sort of personal speaking in nature.
Sure.
Where a writer-director has, we open with his success.
Right.
He's at an Oscar party or something like that. Maybe he was nominated, but he didn't win, and they're asking, like, well, what's the next project? Well, I'm working on something right now. I'm not really ready to talk about it, but it'll be coming out soon.
Right.
He goes home to his trophy wife. She wants to become a reality star, an auto-tune singer, whatever the case may be.
Right, yeah.
He's like, all right, well, I'm going to go do something really artistic and leave you here to that.
She's banging the pool boy.
Possibly.
Right.
Okay. We'll work out all the little details later. Long story short, he dies.
Right.
I would imagine heart attack or choking on a ham sandwich.
While in bed. Yeah. Not autoerotic asphyxiation.
No. That wouldn't be a very fun one to shoot, I think.
I think you and I disagree, but what would be fun to shoot? I don't know that you have any personal experience with it.
No.
Eyeballing it and writing it, so.
I've never choked myself while beaten off.
Did you ever see Adaptation?
Read
Adaptation?
Yeah.
You know that you've crossed that boundary that, who are the brothers who wrote that or directed it?
It's Kaufman.
Yeah. Where he's like, we've crossed the dimension now. Now you're officially writing yourself into your own story. That's essentially what you're doing.
Not wholly.
Well, not you. It's just basically about you. It's about
Well, no, I mean, it
something.
Started with a thought about writing, which right. I imagine that a lot of other writers have had, and I imagine would be interesting to see.
Now, and the other thing I want you to do is to actually write something, and I want that to become part of it.
Well, that's the thing I was discussing with you.
Yeah.
So the idea is he's writing something, and he dies. An unfinished first draft. We're going to imagine that in this world, this writer writes the entire first draft and then edits from there.
Like a normal person?
Right, rather than editing as he writes.
Right.
Like I do. By editing as I write, I mean murdering everything that I wrote.
Deleting whole cloth and starting over.
Throwing it in a park somewhere.
Yes.
Calling my best friend from Best Buy, having him take me there.
From a non-existent phone.
From a phone that ain't outside, I can tell you that.
No, it's not.
But yeah, so the idea was that I was going to actually put my real first draft as the movie first draft in the short film.
Right.
So you would actually be able to see for yourself. This would just be like the first take. I'm just writing 14 page or whatever, you know. It's
right.
Probably going to be like 4 pages for the
sure.
The actual thing. But like, you know, I'm going to actually write 4 pages and not touch them.
Which
and it'll just
should.
Be a stupid first draft and put it out there in the world.
Right.
And then Rob can go like, wow, you are a heck.
Maybe. Or I could be like, oh, see, the world didn't end. You're fine.
Yeah. I'm still worried about it. I don't think you'll ever change my mind on this, but
Anyway, so then what happened? So the wife.
Yeah, the now widow.
Right.
In an attempt to get her career going and get a little extra money from the deal.
Yeah.
Sells the first draft, and they make a movie out of it.
Mm-hmm.
And then at the end of it all, people love it.
Right.
Like they're just like, oh, the last great work of a dying artist.
Right.
Like Heath Ledger in Dark Knight.
Except for Heath Ledger in Dark Knight was a fantastic.
Oh yeah, I'm not saying it wasn't.
And you are a horrible hack, so it will be horrible. And they will only like it because you're dead.
I'm not saying Heath Ledger isn't a great actor, but there's some people who you'll hear say like, oh, that's the greatest acting role ever in the history of ever. Right. I'm just like, oh, let's. It was really good. There's an argument to be made of whether or not he's the best Joker.
Right.
So let's not.
Wait. I don't think there is an argument about that.
You don't?
No. That he's the best Joker?
You can't make a reasonable argument that Jack was better?
I think that Jack was the
Joker.
He's
different.
He's different, but Jack was the Joker in the way that the 60s TV show. It was a darker version of the TV show.
Well, I don't think that's Jack's fault. I think that's Tim Burton's fault.
Perhaps, but Jack was limited by his director.
Right.
And what all actors who are limited by hack-ass writers and directors know is that when you're trying to say that the Orioles are in town and you're talking to Colin... Oh, wait, sorry, I got off topic there. no, that Jack is limited because the character was written that way.
Yeah.
So he can't be the best Joker. That's not his fault. He was just limited by the way it was written.
I disagree. I think...
You didn't read the Batman comics growing up, did you?
Thumbed through them.
I'm upset. I am upset by your trying to interspose yourself into this conversation. Then
I'm fine
because Heath is much closer to the Joker from the comics.
Maybe the later Joker.
The Joker of my formative youth.
Right. When it was more about Arkham and less about tomfoolery.
Yeah, let's get dark because the Joker actually murders people.
Right.
Which is how a real supervillain would work. Unlike Jack Nicholson's character, who doesn't successfully kill anybody.
But
the entire
first Batman run was more about, like, an ode to the older style.
Right.
It wasn't the first Batman 89?
Yep.
So, the formative Batmans of your youth weren't really in vogue at that point.
But no, the darker...
Because that really started in the 90s, if I remember correctly.
No. The darker comics had been out throughout the 70s and 80s.
All right.
They went back to the campy 50s and 60s Batmans and made them seem look dark but be the campy characters.
To be fair, there might have been a lot of like people higher up than Tim Burton sort of
right.
pushing him in the direction that he should go. You know, people are going to want to take their kids to this, you know?
Who was the Joker?
You have like a Joker where it's like, you know, like, you know, I got these scars, you know, like
right,
that's a little bit too much for kids when we were young. Not so much for kids these days.
Yeah.
With their sexting and their Tinder and their fucking their avatars.
Who played the Joker in the show? Viggo something? I was going to say Viggo Mortensen.
That's not
who
it
is.
Not it.
Not who it is. Don't look that up.
I don't know. Do you want me to IMDb it?
No, it's all right. All I know is that he played the character like the campy comics. Jack Nicholson did a darker version of him. And then Heath Ledger took the character in a whole different direction. It's wholly separate. I don't think you can even put it in the same...
Related sidebar,
yeah.
What do you think about the news of Jared Leto playing the Joker?
Has it been confirmed? I thought that was a rumor.
I heard confirmed, but...
Nah, I thought it was a rumor.
Some people may say confirmed and mean rumor.
I think that... What is he playing it on Gotham? Where is he playing it? A new Batman movie?
Suicide Squad?
Oh, yeah.
Will Smith's going to be in it.
Yeah. I'm fine with that. I think that they are trying to keep... I think Jared is not going to be able to put on as good a performance as that one. Yeah.
Okay. There,
Caesar.
There are five people listed here on IMDb, actors who played the Joker from best to worst.
Yeah. Best?
In the opinion of this...
Oh, I'm sorry.
Person who put this list together.
Right. Who's number one now?
Heath Ledger, which
right.
I won't deny. I like Heath Ledger's performance better. I'm just saying there's a reasonable argument to be made for Jack.
Sure, okay. Who's second?
Jack.
Yeah.
And then Mark Hamill.
When did Mark Hamill play the Joker?
I think he was in one of the recent cartoons.
Because I know that he played the Joker-like character on Jay and Silent Bob Strike Back, but I don't think...
That was Cock Puncher.
He was a Joker-based
character.
Joker-based character. Yeah. Nobody expects Cock Puncher.
And then it's Cesar Romero.
Who is the old campy sitcom.
Yeah. Tall, suave, and sophisticated. Cesar Romero actually had two claims to fame in Hollywood. To one generation, he was the distinguished Latin lover of numerous musicals and romantic comedies, and the rogue bandit, the Cisco Kid, in a string of low-budget westerns. However, to a younger generation, weaned on television, no more. And then Kevin Michael Richardson also apparently played the Joker.
In what?
Mm-hmm.
The voiceover.
Probably another cartoon?
Yeah.
I would imagine?
Yeah.
Because I don't think they'd let a big black guy be the Joker.
Probably not.
Not right away, at least.
The new Captain America's going to be black, so. Not in what? The movies, in the comics.
Oh, okay. Mm.
Hawkman or something?
I was going to say Chris Evans is doing all right as the Joker. Or as Captain America. So.
But nonetheless, so I like Jared Leto, and if they take the Suicide Squad in the way that they should, it's very dark, and it's
and Margot Robbie is Harley Quinn,
which is gonna be good.
Yeah,
I'm excited to see her. And who? What's the other female character? Anyway,
yeah,
I like Suicide Squad comics. It's actually not called Suicide Squad. I don't remember exactly, but the comic book itself. I think the later version. It sucks being in 2014 because, like, I remember these things, but I can't say.
I hope Google isn't making assumptions just because I typed in suicide.
What did it say? Suicide Squad. Was
Suicide
the first
Squad.
One. Yeah.
2016 IMDb.
There
I wonder if they have these all listed.
There we go.
Yep. Margot Robbie is Harley Quinn. Tom Hardy is Rick Flagg. Jake Courtney is Boomerang. Jared Leto is the Joker. Kara Delevingne, Enchantress, and Will Smith as Deadshot. Oh, and Jesse Eisenberg is rumored as Lex Luthor.
I don't like that. Now my opinion of the movie has gone down.
Why, because of Jesse Eisenberg?
Will Smith playing.
Didn't he play Lex Luthor already?
I don't think so.
Or is he going to be Lex Luthor? Or?
Maybe in the Superman Batman movie.
Maybe.
That's the crossover there.
Right.
By the way, DC, get your shit together. For fuck's sake, get your shit together. You're behind the eight ball already.
Why are they behind the eight ball?
Because the Marvel has jumped way out in front of them with all of the movies and everything.
Marvel
is the better brand.
Marvel is owned by Disney.
Now.
Who's a factory if they wish to be.
Right.
They can just churn out these things like crazy.
Right.
And even though they're still in the big six.
Yeah.
DC and Warner Brothers can't seem to get their shit together.
That's what I mean.
Yeah.
Like, get your shit together and pump out some movies.
Is it Warner?
Yeah, I know.
It's Warner.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Ben Affleck is Batman? Come on. Now he's two characters in the same fucking universe! He's two characters! Although, now Tom Hardy's three!
Yeah.
Tom Hardy is three characters in the same fucking universe!
Different universes. Oh, no, because Batman's DC. Never mind. Fuck me.
But now, like, stop it. Stop it.
Yeah.
When
there's other people who can be people.
When somebody said, "Oh, we're making a Deadpool movie," there was no discussion. It was like, "How much money do we have to get Ryan Reynolds for him to be in this?"
Yeah.
Ryan Reynolds, who, by the way, has a character in both universes.
Yeah.
But refused to pick up a third character, which was going to be in the DC universe. He said, "Wait, don't I already aren't I already a hero in the DC universe?
Yeah.
I should probably just leave it at that. But Deadpool, I'll do that."
Again, well, they probably want to recast all these roles.
Stop it. Stop it. Stop it.
You know what I think they're worried about is the Robert Downey Jr. effect of Iron Man.
What about it?
Well, because originally they hired Robert Downey Jr. to a decent contract for
Iron
Man. Yeah. But then as soon as it blew up and it was like, I think they weren't imagining that it would be as popular as it was.
Right.
Even though Iron Man is a pretty popular character.
Pay the man. So
now it's super popular and they got to make more.
Right.
So now they got to pay him. And then as soon as they want to get him in the Avengers, he just knows, like, all right, well, you're not going to replace me.
Right.
I basically am Tony Stark.
And he is.
Yeah. I mean, there's nobody really else who can play that character.
Well, that's because he was Tony Stark, by the way.
Yeah.
Like, look at the comic book and look at him.
Yeah, it wasn't really that much of a stretch. But.
He's like, all right, so I'm going to shave my beard in a funny shave, and now I'm Tony Stark.
Yeah.
Okay. But the thing
and
is,
that does it.
they're going to clear the money, though. You pay him more, but having him in it clears more money, and you're going to make more money.
Yeah, but it's just one of those, you know, it's like negotiating. Like, you don't want to be behind the eight ball on it. You don't want to have to be like where he's just like, $40 million or go fuck yourself. He's just like, ugh.
The thing is, though, that he enjoys playing.
Yes, I'll write you $40 million check. Jesus Christ.
He enjoys playing the character. I don't think that he hasn't done what he could do. Because here's the thing. If he wanted to, and Avengers 2, everybody's already under contract for Avengers 2 or Avengers 3 or whatever, and Downey's like, $400 million.
Yeah.
What are you going to do? He is the central character of the movie. We're either not going to have the movie or you're going to pay him that much.
I think you don't have the movie.
And that's the choice they would make.
Because you wouldn't make up the money.
He's not adding $400 million worth of value.
Right.
We just don't make the movie. But he hasn't done that.
Yeah.
He's been, I'll enjoy the character.
If I remember correctly, he held out for other people's money.
Yes.
In Avengers 2.
Yeah.
Like, he was just like, it's kind of fucked up that you're not paying everybody else like you're paying me. So,
it wasn't everybody else. It was Chris Hemsworth. It was the major players. He's like
the people who came into the Avengers.
You've built these characters.
Right.
They should be on a pace. Shit. They should be on a pace.
I came back.
They should be on a pace scale.
Rob hit the mic.
But there should be a steady pace scale.
Right.
If we have the prequel movie, the Thors, the Captain Americas, all those, that's one level. And then below that is the characters you're building around, and then below that is the third-rate people. So, anyway, but he did. He held out for the money because he's a good guy.
Yeah, that's good guy, Robert Downey Jr.
Yeah. You know who else is a good guy?
Who?
Adnan Syed.
Oh, real quick. Before we get
that segue?
Yeah. Before we get into that?
Yeah.
In the show notes, I would like very much, while we're talking about Robert Downey Jr., if you put up that meme of him and, what's his face, in the car... in the Acura.
Fuck. No idea what you're talking about.
The guy who played Hulk. God damn it.
Ed Norton.
No. New Hulk.
Mark Ruffalo. Yes.
Where the two of them are in the car and it's like, get in, nerds. We're going to do science.
That's right.
I like that. It makes me laugh every time I say it. I'd like to laugh again.
I will try to put that in.
So, all right. Good.
So, anyway. So, like, you know who's a good guy?
Who?
Adnan Syed.
Oh, I love cereal.
We did that.
Yeah.
So
it's almost like it didn't happen.
Right. So what I would like to do first of all is to say a huge thank you to Liz, who turned me on to Serial.
Yeah.
Who was like, there is this thing, you should listen to it in week two. She listened to week one. She said, hey, you should listen to this. You're gonna love it. And I do love it, and now all of America loves it.
Yeah.
And I like to think I single-handedly caused America to love it. Because I did post a lot about it on social media.
Yeah, and you do have a high clout score.
And as you know, my clout score is 66. So
because
there's that.
The people at Clout are very impressed with the progress you've done.
Right.
They have you on a watch list.
Yeah.
Unlike the government watch list, which I'm sure
we're
all getting arrested for soon enough.
Right.
Anybody who knows you is soon going to be dragged in by people in black sunglasses.
I am waiting for the first person to be like, yeah, so I got approached by somebody who was like, is he really dangerous or is he full of shit? Like, I'm waiting for that, but...
The men in black are just standing by the side of my bed when I wake up.
Well, you know, the true story...
And they just look at me and they're like, we have questions about Robert Cheek. Also, you snore a lot.
But the true men in black have unblinking, too large for their face, unblinking eyes, and really big smiles. Mm-hmm. And they talk without their lips moving.
You should talk to my dad. He had a Men in Black experience.
Did he?
Yeah.
Like actual Men in Black?
Yeah.
Or like the Men in Black, like guys in suits who came up and
No, like the actual Men in Black.
Seriously?
Yeah.
I want to talk to you. We got to
talk. He had some sort of thing where like he was trying to drive away from them and one of them was like running after his car at like a tremendous speed.
What?
He's just like,
how is that like,
it wasn't human how fast they ran or something like that.
How has he not told me about this before?
I don't know.
How have I not heard this story?
He's got stories.
Jesus Christ.
Maybe I should just get him to call in so everybody can hear about it.
I think that I might actually be your dad's son.
Really?
We both have those crazy stories, like shit just happens to us randomly.
Right.
I like that. Although Men in Black, I would like to have a visit. Just give me that story.
So, if you're listening out there, Men in Black.
That, right. Pay attention. So, anyway.
Men in Black does subscribe to us on YouTube.
Yeah, obviously, yeah.
Secret Government Agency 1 username on
Not the FBI van outside your house.
Man, that pizza guy's been here for a while.
What kind of pipes? What kind of delivery of flowers is that? That has been there all day.
Why does a Ford Transit Connect deliver pizzas? That doesn't make very much sense.
The dish on top sitting around?
I was wondering how they did that Domino's pizza tracker.
Exactly. That's what it is.
Yeah.
Anyway, so today.
I am waiting for the day, just sidebar, where like with pizza or package specifically, right. Like if I order something from like Amazon, it comes UPS.
I can actually look on
like
it.
Where I like pull up the UPS app on my phone and I can see the truck driving like around the streets.
Yep.
So I'm just like, all right, he's already in Parkville, so I know it's going to be.
I don't think they will ever do it that direct. You know why?
Because then people just drive up and get their packages.
That, and you could just knock the truck over too.
I guess.
It's although you can see it, obviously.
I wouldn't be able to. Well, if they know the route,
right?
Like they have the route planned out in advance,
right?
Maybe they could say something like, "Your package will be delivered approximately at 3:30."
Now that,
and then I would know, like, okay, right. Be home.
And then it updates, and it's like, turns out 3:45. Turns out 5:30.
I feel like there's got to be some sort of algorithm that can figure that out.
Well, I'm just picturing that the guy.
Maybe we should pitch that to the good people at UPS.
Yes.
For $1 million, we'll give you the idea of an algorithm. I'm sorry.
No, you have to do it yourself. You're going to have to look it up yourself.
You're going to have to figure it out.
We just had the idea of it. Yeah. That's all.
We don't have access to your servers.
So I had some extra time in the Baltimore area today, and I had not listened to episode 11? 11?
The most recent.
Rumors? Yes. Yeah. Of the
penultimate episode?
Pentultimate?
Am I saying that incorrect?
Pentultimate is how you say
it. Okay, whatever. I'll fix it in post.
So,
Not, because I'm lazy.
I was thinking that, I've been listening to this thing, and I know these places. I've heard some of these places before.
Mm.
I mean, Baltimore. You know, there are people all across the world who are like, this Lincoln Park place sounds really crazy.
Yeah.
I can drive there. I know where that is. So, I took a couple hours this afternoon. Anybody who follows me on Instagram, at Robert Nitschik, you would have been able to see me on my trails around. And Serial Podcast is coming up to their last episode this Thursday.
Right.
And everyone should take the time to catch up and then listen to the podcast on Thursday.
I've been wondering quietly to myself.
Yeah.
With big time shows, you have to worry about spoilers.
Right.
Like, when The Walking Dead's on, if you're not, like, able to watch it. Like, I was at an airport.
Right.
When
The Walking Dead, yeah. They spoiled their own show.
Right. But, yeah. I mean, like, I got the spoiler because I happened to be on Facebook at the time in the airport. I'm just like, well, now I know.
Yeah.
Still haven't watched it yet, by the way.
Yeah, and we're not going to spoil it for you. We're not going to tell you. But I'm sure everyone heard the story about how AMC spoiled their own show for their West Coast viewers.
Yeah.
Which is where you were.
Yeah, because I was in San Francisco.
Right.
But the...
I'm listening to that on Thursday morning.
Yeah.
I have no court.
Oh, yeah.
Because I don't want it to be spoiled.
Well, I'm going to listen to it, like, first thing. Like, it's going to be the first thing I listen to on Thursday. But I'm still worried that, like, you know, I can't log on to Facebook. Because maybe somebody's just like, oh, my God, they found out it was Jay the whole time. And I'm like, fuck!
Which we don't know that it's Jay.
Right.
We don't know that it's Jay.
Yeah.
But I think that that's where we're going.
Probably Jay.
Probably Jay.
Yeah.
What
is your, since, like, episode 2.
Right.
My opinion has been he did not get the best legal defense in the world. And that was cleared up when...
Episode 10.
Yeah, where they talked about the actual legal defense. Do you have any opinions on this as a member of the court?
Yes, and I was going to say...
A member of that tribe?
I had the same thought. Episodes 2, 3, 4, you know, we're building, and I'm like, why is it that this newspaper writer is being able to find these things that the legal team just couldn't find?
Yeah.
And I think it's episode 4 where they talk about the girl who writes him a letter.
Mm.
And that was the one. That was the one where I was like, something's up with this attorney. Because if I get that, I chase that down.
Yeah.
The family gave her $25,000. I have not yet had a case for which I charged $25,000. I've charged $10,000 for a case. That was super involved.
Yeah.
Expert testimony, the whole nine. $25,000, that was her retainer, and it actually went above that. I think all told, they spent about $100,000 on experts and the two trials and everything. And I said, why would you not chase down this girl? She said she never talked to the lawyer. And then when I saw episode 10 being promoted, and they're like, we talk about the case, we talk about the lawyer, Christina Gutierrez, we talk about all this stuff. I'm like, okay, so we're going to get cleared up.
Right.
This is why she didn't, because she said, oh, I did talk to her, one of her legal assistant who was on episode 9 is going to have a bigger role. I was like, oh, no, we talked to her. What did she say? We didn't talk to her? We talked to her. And I'm like, ah, oh, damn it, Serial, way to build me up for 9 weeks thinking that this is the – no.
Right.
No. They didn't talk to her. Flaws in the case. A lot of – she and I think I've told you this before, and I tell my clients, especially when I do appeals for people, I say that being a lawyer is a lot like being a painter, that if Picasso was to look at someone else, or probably more specifically someone else was to look at Picasso, they would say, that's shit.
Yeah.
None of that looks right. What, you think this is good? I'm trying to think of a realist.
Well, not only that, but like – it's something that I think other people don't realize is that lawyers are not all the same. Forget about skill.
Yes.
Forget about where you went to school. Forget all about that. All the credentials that a lawyer may have.
Right.
Like, you know, I can't say to myself, like, well, I'm covered in any situation because my dad's a lawyer and Rob's a lawyer. And then right. I have, I'm good for that.
Yeah.
If I get arrested for murder... My dad's never done a murder trial. You've never done a murder trial. You know, could one of the two of you figure it out?
Yeah.
But this is my freedom we're talking about. Right. I don't want to just wing somebody out there the first time on a murder trial.
Yeah.
I want a murder attorney, like somebody who has covered this thing and does it all the time.
Let me tell you how that works. 9 times out of 10, you're in a big law firm and you're sitting in the gallery while two attorneys are on the case.
Yeah.
As an attorney, I'm sitting in the gallery and then I move up to second chair. Before I moved to first chair.
Right.
And if someone came to me with a murder, I would say, I can walk you through the pretrial process. Like, I'm going to get you out on bail the best I can, all that stuff.
Right.
But when it comes to the murder trial, no. You need somebody who's done a murder before.
Well, also, people like to bitch about OJ, which obviously was 20 years ago. But, like, the reason why OJ was off was because he had Cochran and Kardashian and who was the other one?
Martha was the... state's attorney.
Yeah. Can't remember the other guy.
I could see him. I could see him sitting
at the
table.
Face.
Anyway, but no.
Yeah.
Who had a combined, like, 50 years of murder cases.
Yeah, and the best in the business. Like, the absolute, like, that was the dream. They called it the dream team, but it was the dream team of murder defense.
If you had millions of dollars, that's
the reason why he got off was because of those three.
Right.
They were able to do everything they could to keep that reasonable doubt alive.
Right, and was it Jimmy Cochran?
And get things thrown out, and
getting, and let me tell you, the key to a murder trial is your pretrial motions, which you don't see a lot of, but the O.J. Simpson trial, the shit that you didn't see made him look way more guilty.
Right.
And it was the amount
of shit they got thrown out just on, like, Furman being racist, quote-unquote, and, like, well, I'm not saying he's not racist, I'm just saying, like, you know.
They argued he was racist.
Yeah, the argument was he was racist. And the LAPD is racist, and
And Cochran was the one who said try on the glove, right? If I remember correctly, no. Cochran pointed out that they didn't have him try on the glove, and then on redirect, the state told him to put on the glove, and it didn't fit.
Right.
And brilliant. Again, that's what 50 years of experience does for you.
Right.
Because Johnny looks at that and is like, there ain't no way that glove's gonna fit.
Yeah.
It's got blood. Well, it's been shrunk.
Not only that, but like, you got the blood
rubber,
on it.
Rubber
it's
glove.
Shrunk. And if you don't want to put on a glove, it's not that hard to, like...
It doesn't fit.
It's not working. It's
right.
Not happening.
And I can't say that, as genius as I think I am, that I would have thought of that.
Right.
That I would have seen the glove and I would have pointed out an argument that they never try on the glove.
But there was, like, that moment in the defense episode...
Yeah.
Where... what was it? Fuck. God damn it. That big thing that she could have capitalized on...
Jay's attorney? No.
Yeah, Jay getting an attorney from the...
From the state.
State.
Yeah. Which, well, let me go back before we get to that. So, I look at Christina Gutierrez...
Like a pro bono real attorney, not a state's attorney. Or a public defender, I mean.
I look at Christina Gutierrez, and I say, much like some realist would look at Picasso and say, that's bullshit, I don't argue cases the same way. I don't argue the same case the same way as your dad would. Yeah. No two lawyers are alike. We all have a different style.
You wouldn't hire Picasso to do a portrait.
Right. But, they are both good in their own right.
Yeah.
So, not even the type of case, but even if I haven't, there are other family law attorneys who are very, which is what I do a lot of, who are very fact, 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 fact. And they paint a very good picture for you. And they make good criminal attorneys because they hit fact, 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 fact.
Yeah.
I get called on cases that the person is clearly guilty because my style is more, let's forget about the facts. Let me tell you about this person. Let me paint you a story that makes them look good and makes the state look bad or whatever.
Yeah.
Or my guy who is the worst father in the world just basically worked.
Has the coffee cup to prove it. Worst dad alive.
Like, picking up shifts so he doesn't have to go home to his family, but now they're getting divorced and I got to make him look like a good guy.
Yeah.
I can turn that. I turn that into, this guy is killing himself, doing 90 hours a week at a job.
Yeah.
Now, what you don't know is that he sat in my office like, these fucking kids, but this bitch is not going to get me for child support. I need you to help me out with that. So I make him look like, oh, well, he broke his back because he had somebody at home. Meanwhile, she's banging the guy next door. Now, I can't prove that she's banging the guy next door, but he happens to be sitting in the gallery right now.
Yeah.
Let's be honest. Anyway, so that's my style. And other people would say, here's a fact, 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 fact. And that all builds up to a certain conclusion.
Well, it depends. Every trial is going to be different, too. Right. Like, there's no two trials that are exactly the same.
And we heard from two different trials for Adnan, and they both sounded much different. Her tone was much different.
Yeah.
But the what happened for Jay was that the state's attorney, the district attorney, we call them state's attorneys in Maryland.
Right.
Found a private attorney to represent Jay in his case. The case that he got a deal for because he testified against Adnan.
Got the plea for.
He got a plea for.
Yeah.
But that is unheard of.
Right.
That is unheard of. And the judge saying that he didn't realize he was that was conferring a benefit is bullshit. I don't care.
Oh, well.
Jay is a fantastic liar.
How much is a bad lawyer?
Oh, surprisingly, about the same amount as a good lawyer. There are people who should not be attorneys. People I know who should not be attorneys.
I mean, like, if I Googled, find me the cheapest lawyer I can possibly get.
Right. You would do district court case for $500, maybe $750.
Right.
You know what I charge? $750 to $1,000.
Yeah.
It's about the same, because the thing is, it's about more experience. If you're a really bad lawyer, but you've been doing it for 20 years, they could charge what your dad charges.
Right.
It doesn't matter, because they've been doing it for 20 years.
Right. The credibility of doing it for a certain amount of time allows you to up the rate based off of that.
Right. So even if you're a bad lawyer, but you've been doing bad law for a long time, if you're still in business, you can charge more.
But it's almost hard to believe that he wouldn't have been able to find somebody to take his case,
well, he didn't
or
have
to pay for it.
He didn't have to.
Right. But I'm saying, like, you know, it's an inevitability that if you get in trouble, you're going to have to pay for a lawyer.
Yes.
You're going to have to find a way to do it.
Yes.
So I don't see why that is not a benefit to have one given to you.
And that's the thing.
Even though the argument was made that he didn't realize that it was a benefit.
Yeah. And so therefore it didn't corrupt his statement. But he is the person who had more to gain from that entire thing going down than anybody else.
Yeah.
He was intimately involved, but didn't do it. Now, and I'm not saying that Jay did it. I think that there's a much higher likelihood that he did it than Adnan did it. But it also could have been anybody. The other thing I will say, the one thing my trip today really got in my head is that the timeline doesn't fucking make sense.
There is timeline problems.
Yeah.
And I don't think that Sarah necessarily denies that.
Right.
If I remember correctly, I was talking to you about this earlier, the trip from the high school to Best Buy.
Yes.
Which was done on a similar, like, they left school at the same time. Yeah.
Right, yeah.
You were doing it on Saturday, which is a little different. But.
Right, and given even that flex, I told you that one thing that happened to me that didn't happen to her, which happens a lot in Baltimore when you're riding down side streets or even major boulevards.
Yeah.
Is that people just walk out in front of you. And somebody a few cars out in front of me, somebody just decided to walk across the street randomly.
Mm.
Everybody slammed on their brakes, and then we sit there for a while afterward because you're like, once one person starts to go,
then 10 people start to go.
Right, because like, oh, well, everybody stop. Let's run across here.
Yeah.
So that happened to me, and it slowed me down. But even on a Saturday, I got there in plausible time for it to happen. There are other problems that I don't like. Yeah. One is that the place in the mall, Jay's Map, doesn't really make sense. For those of you who have seen the images of Jay's Map, I could not match that up to any place in the Best Buy parking lot.
Yeah.
Number two, the phone doesn't exist. That is the one reason I went to the fucking Best Buy.
The exterior phone.
The exterior phone never existed from what I can tell. I've been out. I've been all around the building. There were two spots I located where it could have been, depending on what Jay's Map orientation was. Both of them, in the end, I didn't find a place where a phone could be.
Yeah.
Now, somebody I'd seen online said that there was a spot inside, and I went inside and looked, and I agree with that person that there may have been a phone there. Based on there's a patch of carpet on the floor and discoloration on the wall, as if it was removed.
Yeah.
But Jay's testimony was that Adnan was standing by the phone. He called him from the phone, and he was standing by the phone, and he saw him when he rolled in the parking lot. First of all, if the phone is where I think it should be, based on his map, you wouldn't be able to see Adnan when you came in the parking lot. He would have to circle way around to get there.
Yeah.
Two, if it was where it makes no sense for it to be, there is no phone there.
Not only that, but the argument of how long, like, with the timeline.
Yes.
The actual murder taking place, like.
There is no time for a fight. Why would Hay go to that place alone with him if he was pissed off already?
Yeah.
Otherwise, he gets pissed off and kills her in, like, 3 minutes.
And not only that, the argument could be, like, you know, I can't remember what she said, the kill time, what she figured the amount of time it would take to strangle.
3 minutes.
3 minutes?
No, that's how much time they had. 3 minutes.
Oh, to strangle and put her in the trunk?
Yes.
Yeah, I mean, it's tough to do that by hand.
Right.
Because as soon as you get your hands around somebody's throat, they're not just like, oh, well, this is the end. Like,
right.
If you shoot somebody in the head, then there's no time for them to think about it.
Now,
if you stab somebody in the heart, there's no time for them to be like, you know, like, stop stabbing me.
Right, but choking them out is a whole different beast.
Yeah, that's a...
Yeah, so here's what I'll say.
And I would like to say, I mean, it's not a legal argument.
Right.
But it keeps getting repeated over and over again. Adnan's a good guy.
Yeah.
I think there's something you can say about, like, whether or not you would be reasonably surprised if somebody choked out somebody else.
Right.
Like, if it was me and you, if somebody said, like, did you hear that Rob got arrested for choking out somebody? I'd be like, I guess I could see it happening.
Yeah, I was going to say, don't lie to yourself and tell you that you don't.
No, no, I mean, I could believe that.
Yeah.
If you said, did you hear Corey got arrested for choking out somebody? You'd be like, doesn't really make a ton of sense.
No.
Corey doesn't seem like that type.
No. And he doesn't deal with those kind of people either.
Right.
I deal with bitches that need to be choked out occasionally.
I don't have unsavory characters in my...
Right. But what I did when I drove around today was, in a light most favorable to the plaintiff, or to the state in this case.
Yeah.
To try and build a case. The one location where it could have been was very quiet, and it could have happened there. Timeline still doesn't make sense. But the other place where the phone makes sense and the map that Jay made makes more sense, you're in full view of the highway. Now, if you go out there several months after the death, when they supposedly, I guess, were investigating it in March and April and May, this line of trees that separates you from the highway would be in full bloom and you wouldn't be able to see anything. I'm out there in December, much how it looked in February when the murder occurred. You'd be able to see everything from the highway. We would see... And the parking lot's busy. Again, I don't know because it was a Saturday rather than a weekday. But anyway, aside from that, the other parts of the timeline about driving to different places, I didn't go to the cliffs. In fact, when I got here, I asked you if you'd ever been there.
Yeah.
Because there's no good way to get there. And in my mind, looking at the map and thinking about driving it, I was just like, there's no way. It's going to take me way long time to get there.
Yeah.
So I didn't even go there.
Well, made the argument of like where they dropped the body too, and how difficult it would have been.
Yeah, so I was there approximately. We are losing light. My assumption is that in February it would have been about the same amount of time before the clocks change. Excuse me, before the clocks change, so that, you know, sunset's about the same time. We're a little closer to the solstice than they were, so maybe a little light, a little longer, but you're in full view. There's no place to stop. There's no place to pull over. Or you're carrying a body, I don't know, 300, 400 feet.
Yeah.
Now, you can stop where the in the story they talk about how the guy stopped to take a leak.
Yeah.
I don't see a place to pull over there. I don't see a place to stop and pee there. So that doesn't make sense to me either.
Well, not only that, but the if it's you really have to pee, like, immediately, you can't hold it any more seconds.
Yeah.
Then I imagine if you're just pulled over on this road where there's no good place to pull over.
Yeah.
You're not walking 250 feet into the woods either.
You pop the door open and you take a piss behind the door.
Yeah, or you just, like, you know, open up the gas cap or something, or put the hood up and just, like, make stand it look on the side of the truck.
Yeah, exactly.
You know.
But I didn't see a place to pull over right there, so Mr. S's story about stumbling on the body didn't make much sense to me either. Now, there looked like there was some new, there's some new barriers put up, and part of me wondered if the new barriers have been put up since this whole thing started.
Well, there's a lot of things that could have changed in the in the years since.
But my assumption is looking at the vegetation. That was the number one thing. Looking at the vegetation, they make a point about how you can see where the body is.
Mm-hmm.
And if you were looking to try and get where you couldn't be seen, you would need to go further.
Yeah.
So Mr. S's thing about I only went out that far to pee because you couldn't see me, you could absolutely see. I could see the damn log that they talked about.
Yeah.
There was a place a little further down where you can go into this little parking area, and you go down the hill, and it's completely hidden. And I went down there specifically because I was like, why wouldn't you pull here? You drive past this every single day. This is where I take a leak. I pull over, get over the hill just enough that I could take it out, whip it out, and take a piss, and then get back in, and I'm gone.
Yeah.
None of that made sense to me. And I felt bad. I drove past – the other thing about it is I drove past the place six times. And I did that because every time I tried to stop to, like, take it in a little bit to take a picture, somebody came up behind me. Now, again, it was maybe an hour and a half earlier than when Jay and Adnan were supposedly there doing it. But it doesn't make any sense.
I don't
sense
feel like you would leave that much up to chance, though.
No, you go in.
Like,
if I'm trying
to hide a body.
Yeah.
Number one, great choice of park for doing it.
There, because there's a lot of bodies.
Horrible place to. The description of where they left it, I haven't been there to observe it like you have, but the description of how close they were to the road confused
and to the trail.
Me. Yeah.
By the way, the ability of someone to stumble on it from the trail or the road. Ridiculous.
Right. Doesn't make sense.
When there are, I see it bad saying it, but there are tons of better places.
Yeah.
If they had gone from the parking lot the
other
direction.
Fucking whip a brick around her legs and throw her in the bay. Like, it's not that.
They talked about going to the bay a lot. They went downtown a lot. Really, you could have gone to the inner harbor and, maybe not the inner harbor, but the outer harbor and just dropped her anywhere
just
on the point.
Go to fucking Sparrow's Point or something like
just
that.
Just drop her
in the water.
Yeah.
I'm not trying to tell you how to hide a body, by the way. I'm just. Speaking in generalities, that's what people do.
And here's the other thing I got about that. They would have been much quicker to just drop her and walk. Why would you bury her there? You're just, again, people stumbling upon you burying something there.
The fact...
None of it makes sense.
I just don't... To be fair, I'll never understand criminals.
Yeah.
Because I hear stupid criminal stories all the time where it's just like, you know, like, oh, he fell through the skylight. And it's just like, well, why would he be on the sky? You know, those sorts of things. But, like, in this particular story, there's way too many things where I'm just like, that doesn't make any bit of sense.
No.
As somebody who's not a criminal mastermind.
Yeah. Right.
I imagine I would do a better job of hiding a body than they did.
Yes.
I imagine I would do a better job of killing somebody than they did. If
it happened the way that it supposedly
happened. Yeah, I mean, like, there seems to be a lot of
inconsistencies.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, if it's so easy to drag her wherever you want, like, you know, to pick her up from school and take her to Best Buy and all that sort of stuff, then why aren't you just going on, like, a fucking vacant?
Which, by the way, wasn't that a problem years ago where they were just finding bodies left and right in these vacant buildings?
Well, they still do that because people go in there and do drugs.
Right.
And then fall off. But, like...
No, but there was a time when they were finding dead bodies in the basement
like
that were
murders.
Left there.
Yeah.
And I think it's
well,
probably...
Well, that was in The Wire.
Right.
By the way, my favorite line from the Stephen Colbert
interview
where he's just like, now this takes place in Baltimore, the same fictional story, fictional city from The Wire, right?
Yes.
Just like, I laughed.
But that was on The Wire.
But I think it was based off of something that was similar, but not like you know, they found like 23 dead bodies in Bacon's.
The problem,
all
I
connected
think,
to the same gang, but right, I mean, right, like, right. It was like.
Well, I think part of that, if I remember, it was in
killing
the 90s.
Killing somebody in a Bacon isn't like that.
But no, the problem was they weren't killed there. That was the whole point. They weren't killed there.
Oh,
the
just
bodies
killed
were
and
just
dropped,
dumped
yeah.
There. Yeah. And if I remember, at one point, I think they just stopped looking. And that's what it recurs
well,
to.
Well,
because
nobody thinks about it.
Yeah.
Like, check Bacon's. Because there's a lot of them, too. That's
right.
The other problem.
Well, if I remember.
You
this,
would have a trouble doing that in, like, Manhattan.
Well, no, because yeah, everybody.
Yeah.
Let's
number
tear
one,
down the bacon and
yeah,
put
number,
new up.
Number one, there's not enough Bacon's. Number
yeah.
two.
Well, no, so I'm having trouble. I always have trouble separating The Wire from what happened in Baltimore in the 90s.
Yeah.
It was so much based on reality. But if I remember, there was a spat of them. It was related to one gang that were killing people and dumping them in Bacon's.
Well, it's a lot of dramatization, too.
Well,
like, Kirk Smoke sort of had, like, the casual idea of not enforcing drug law.
Right, yeah.
He didn't, like, actually do it. He didn't actually go through with, like, a Hamsterdam type thing.
Right.
But I think he just, like, in an interview said, like, we'd be a lot better off if we legalized drugs. And then, like, the whole world came down on him. And
right. Well, no, my point being that I think it was not The Wire. I think it was Real Life, where they just stopped looking in Bacon's.
Yeah.
For a while, they were actually going into these Bacon's and saying, let's see if we find bodies in here. And they just kind of stopped because they found a lot of them. And
right.
They were like, we'll stop doing that.
Better let sleeping dogs lay.
So, anyway, so there are much better places. And you know what? The thing, driving around that part of town, I've been there.
Yeah.
I told you, and I don't want to say how I know. I suspect I might have met Jay.
Yeah.
10 years after all of these events happened.
Yeah.
But doing kind of the similar kind of shit that he
yeah,
was doing
still,
in high school.
Still as unsavory as before.
Still as unsavory, and through people who were just as unsavory.
Yeah.
But there's a place in the marker on where Jay's house is that people have put together is it's around the Doubletree Diner at North Rolling and 40.
Yeah.
You know where that is.
In Catonsville, yeah.
Right near a place that we
right near that Starbucks.
Is there a Starbucks there?
Yeah. Across the street.
Oh! And Corey hit his mic too.
See,
yes.
Mine was I got caught on the wire,
yeah.
Though. I was putting my finger up to make a very revealing point. But
right
yeah.
across, yes, you're right. Right across
yeah.
40. The Walmart's there too, down a little further.
Yeah, it's on the... it's Caddy corner or diagonal from the double T.
Yeah. H Mart is right there.
Yeah.
Anyway, so.
And there's like a pit beef stop or something like that on the other
I
side.
Which I frequented a lot, yeah, actually. Anyway, so there's a housing development a little further down Rolling, and I met a guy whose name was Jay, who I assumed was capital J, short for something, not
Joshua,
J-A-Y.
They call
yeah,
him Jay.
Call him
yeah.
Jay. Black guy. Looked kind of similar to the picture that they're saying Jay looks like. So, that's weird to me.
Yeah.
And when I came down Ingleside...
Well, it is Baltimore, so...
Yes. When I was going around where all these places where Woodlawn is, and I went down to where the Crab Stop was and all that stuff, and then Ingleside dumps out on 40, and I'm like, oh, shit, I was here all the time.
Yeah.
I know these places.
Right.
So, that was weird for me. But none of it makes sense. The overarching point of my day today is that I don't know the people. I don't know the interactions between them. I don't know about motivations, but I do know that the fucking story doesn't make sense. That if I told you a fictional, if we made a movie out of this,
yeah.
People would say, that timeline. So wait, he drove.
Well, they have the rule in movies.
Yeah.
Is you're like allowed one unreasonable, like. Leap
jump,
of faith.
One
yeah.
jump, yeah. I'll jump with you for this one.
Right. Like, so if you say, like, you know, like, oh, we got from here to downtown in 10 minutes.
Right.
You'd be like, well, that's a little bit quick, but I'm going to give it to you this once.
Right.
But if you do that and then immediately follow it up with, like, you know, oh, that guy just jumped up the side of a four-story building. I no longer believe.
Yes. Anything
and,
that you've said.
Yeah. Anything. And if you do something that's super unreasonable, like the jumping up the four-story building, then people
yeah.
are just like, well, I'm out of this right away. Like,
right.
You get one if it's quasi-reasonable.
Okay, and using that example, getting from the school to the Best Buy,
quasi-reasonable.
I think it's too much. My experience as a litigator, my experience with these kind of stories says that it's not possible. My experience
yeah.
with Baltimore City traffic in that area of town says it's not reasonable.
Right.
But she did it within a margin of error.
Yeah.
So, given that. But then it falls apart after that. Getting where
I did wonder how fast she drove too, because most people in Baltimore
Right.
Drive very fast.
Now, and I like to think that I drive like a Baltimore citizen. And like I said, they were slamming on the brakes and waiting for somebody to walk across the highway. But otherwise, I'm doing 50 in a 30 zone. Because everybody's doing 50 in a 30
right.
zone.
You're just going with the flow of traffic.
With the flow.
Officer.
Yeah, I'm going with the flow. But, so I'll give you the school to the Best Buy.
Yeah.
But then, 3 minutes for the murder, putting her in the trunk, Jay not knowing exactly where the phone not being appearing to be there at all, the people who knew the Best Buy then saying that there was no phone there. There being a phone, and here's what, I'm a professional liar. I'm willing to admit that as a lawyer, I'm a professional liar in some ways.
No.
Well, so if I'm putting...
Not lawyers.
If I'm putting together this story,
yeah.
And I say, okay, so this guy had to call me. Where can I do that? Oh, there's a phone at that Best Buy. He called me from the Best Buy. That's close enough to school that he could have got there, and he called me from the Best Buy. And then when I rolled in, I saw him standing by the phone, and I picked him up, and then we left. And then we went and smoked at a place that's 40 minutes away, but, oh, shit. No, I mean, I can get there in, like, 25 minutes. I can get there in 25 minutes.
Yeah.
So we get there in 25 minutes, and we smoke, and then we come back another 25 minutes, and then we take the car out to 70, and what does that take, like, 15 minutes? Like, I can put myself in Jay's head putting together the story.
Yeah.
And saying, all of that makes sense, but you don't think about the little details. Yeah, there's a phone at Best Buy. Yeah, I picked up my friend who called me from that phone at Best Buy, but the phone's inside. It's not outside.
Not only that, but isn't there something to be said about a dead body in your trunk?
That dude is real chill with a dead body in the trunk?
Not only that, but, like, I smoke a cigarette outside of a car and walk into it.
Yeah.
And get accused by the people at the rental place of smoking in the car.
Right, yeah, yeah.
If I rent a car, I always have to do that move where I stand outside of the car for 5 minutes and smoke.
Yeah.
An additional 30 seconds of hoping that it all wafts away while I'm standing outside and freezing cold.
You should also do that when you fart outside the car. By the way, as Sarah and I both remember. Because that comes in with you as well.
When you drag it with you.
Yeah, so, but here's the thing. So I'll give you the from the school to the Best Buy. But then shit just continues to not make sense.
Right.
And if I'm putting together a story, if I'm not Jay, if I'm just a murderer and I'm making up a story, yeah, I've gotten from the Best Buy to that place where we smoke in 25 minutes. But that happened on a Sunday when there was no traffic. Now, yeah. In the middle of the week, I could never make that drive through rush hour traffic to get there in time and get back. And by the way, Route 70, where supposedly they stopped the body, it's very anonymous. I've done some shady shit there myself. I know that you could get away with that. So now we're back in the land of plausibility. It's not implausible for you to walk up to a trunk of a car. I open it. We both look in. We realize that it's a fucking body, and I shut it, and nobody pays attention to that.
Yeah.
There could have been somebody three cars down. I was standing there taking pictures, and there were other people there just ignoring the shit out of me.
Yeah.
Who were in my picture. I mean, I wasn't taking
pictures
of them. It was
I made the argument earlier that I'd like to have a recurring theme in my work where people step over dead bodies. And it's like...
Nothing.
Like there's a dead rat on the sidewalk, and you're just like, oh fuck, dead rat. Ugh.
Well, and here's the thing, again, and I'm not to be.
So there is a part of the culture around here that even if like somebody walked by with a shopping cart and looked and saw a dead body in a trunk, they'd just be like, not my problem.
Yeah. Now I was gonna say, and again,
ooh,
there,
that's gonna suck to clean.
You see two, to be what it is, you see two. Brown...
And then when the cops come up and say, "We saw you on the security camera. Look at the trunk when they opened it."
Yeah.
I have no idea what you're talking about, officer.
No.
So you're not going to testify? No. No, I'm not going to.
Not at all. I have no idea.
Haven't you ever heard the expression, snitches get stitches?
Yeah. So, but again, if I'm there at 70, and especially if I'm me in my real life, and I see two brown guys looking into the trunk of a car, and I catch, like, the head of a young girl leaned up against the inside.
Yeah.
You know what I do?
Walk away.
Let's get the fuck out of here. So, no. I mean, I don't think that it would draw that much attention.
I still remember we were driving through some town on the Eastern Shore, and you said, like, if you drive around this block three times, then the guy will come out and try and sell you drugs.
Yeah, yeah.
And then we did it. And then when the guy walked out, like, we were just like, get the fuck out of here.
It actually worked. Yeah. But, you know, it's not just a Baltimore thing.
Yeah.
Anyway, what was I saying? Okay, so here was what it breaks down for to me. I had the ability to go around and see things. It doesn't make sense. And then what I did when I sat and thought about it on my drive here was this. If this was a show on TV, and yeah. I pride myself on picking out the twist ahead of time.
Yeah.
And you hate it because you hate people talking during movies.
Yeah.
But I always love when I can lean over to somebody and be like, that's the guy.
It's the science teacher who did it.
Yeah. And then like 3 hours later, I'm like, yes! Yes! I told you it was a fucking science teacher! Yeah, that kind of thing. So I'm going to ask you this. If we're watching CSI.
Yeah.
And the case of Adnan Syed and Haman Lee comes on and you're watching it. And everything that you know from the first 11 episodes of Serial happens. What do you say? In Act 1, which is, let's say, episodes 1 through 4.
Number one, not guilty, because not enough evidence.
Right.
That's just...
Before that, let's go back. Let's go back to Act 1.
Okay.
Act 1, which is episodes 1 through 4. What this is the beginning of the... Act 1 of the movie or the show.
Right.
You lean over to me and say what?
Well, we're doing it in retrospect, right? So we know he's in jail.
Yeah, but you're watching Serial as a show on television.
Okay. Yeah, yeah.
Act 1, which would be the first 4 episodes, what's your initial reaction to me?
I think Jay did it.
Right, yeah. Okay. So now we build through episode Act 2.
Though I'm not really discounting Mr. S.
Which my next point is...
Did they do a rape kit? I don't ever remember them talking about a rape kit.
No rape kit. She was in the ground too long, so it wouldn't matter.
Yeah, I mean, that to me... Somebody goes missing like that.
Yeah. My first thing you do?
First thought I have is rape murder.
Yep.
Sorry if that's that's me just assuming things about the place I live.
She's a pretty young girl. Okay, so wait. So Act 1, you lean over to me. We're watching this as a television show.
Yeah.
Act 1, they go to commercial and you're like, Jay fucking did it. Yeah, he fucking did it. Yeah, of course he did it. So then Act 2, episodes 5 through 8. What's your initial reaction?
I'm probably swaying with my J or Mr. S.
Right.
Or possibly just somebody completely unrelated, because...
Which is what they do. So episode 1, or act 1, they set you up with some clues about who it might be. Act 2 is making you question your initial perception. And at episode 5, where they started talking about Mr. S, and I'm like, fuck, maybe it was Mr. S.
Yeah.
It's random to stumble on the body that way. And then the coroner goes out there and he can't find the... He almost steps on her head.
Yeah.
Because he can't find the body, but this dude sees it randomly. Come on.
Yeah.
All right, so now Act 3. What's your... Well, it's hard to do, I guess, Act 3.
Yeah, I mean, this is basically... overall...
Yeah.
I don't think when we listen on Thursday, I don't know if we're going to have an answer that satisfies us.
No.
Sarah doesn't seem like the type of person who's going to say, like, my thought on this whole thing, Jay did it.
Right.
You know?
No. And there's not going to be the big reveal.
Yeah, or she's going to be like, and the real murderer was, open up the sealed envelope.
Right.
Somebody completely random.
Right. But so.
I'm not as free.
My work through is this. It's that.
Though I imagine... With the popularity of the show,
yeah,
and how everyone's going to be tuning in for the last one, much like it's going to be like the Walking Dead finale or whatever.
Yeah, yeah.
It's either going to be disappointing or they're going to rile up the internet like you've never seen before.
And let's hope so.
Which might be something that happens.
Right.
You know, she could just be like, Jay did it.
Maybe she would be. I would love for her to say it.
Here's where Jay lives, and everybody race to Catonsville.
Well, I don't think... I don't think she would do that, but I think at the end she might be holding something back and then be like, okay, so I'm not going to say Jay did it or didn't do it, but let's look at this.
I would like if she did it like a fucking Apple press conference back in the day with Steve Jobs.
Right.
Where it's just like the Serial music starts to boop, boop, boop.
Yeah.
Starts playing and she's just like, one more thing. Like,
what's this? Yeah, exactly.
Are you under the impression that Jay did it?
Yeah. So it doesn't matter if Jay did it or not. This is how I do it. I suspected Jay at the end of Act One. I suspected Jay at the end of Act One. And Mr. S threw some unclarity about who it is.
Yeah.
Then I started suspecting Adnan through some of those episodes. Like, shit, maybe he really did do it. Like, and then the legal team sucked. What my legal conclusion as a practicer of this is this. He shouldn't be in jail.
No.
Whether he did it or not, whether Jay did it, whether Mr. S did it, or somebody we don't even know did it, he shouldn't be in jail. The trial, his ineffective assistance of counsel in the first trial that caused a mistrial in the first trial, which probably he would have gotten off from. And then the second trial and the questions about the money and the lawyer being distracted and everything else. He needs an appeal hearing. I think he's going to be released from jail. I think he should be released from jail. If the system works the way it should be working, which we just previously discussed, it doesn't.
Yeah.
He was guilty and tried to prove himself innocent, and it was impossible. But
at this point, it's going to be pretty tough to overturn anything, though.
So. It is, and that's the sad part, is once you lose, it's appeals very hard. But he should have – there was more than reasonable doubt that he did it.
Yeah.
And under the standard the law sets, if there is reasonable doubt, you are not guilty. And I think he's not guilty. I'm not saying he didn't do it, and I'm not saying Jay did it. I kind of think Jay did it. But I'm saying that under the standard of the law, he should have been found not guilty because there was reasonable doubt that he did it.
Yeah. Anywho.
Yeah.
Everybody tune into Serial. And good for them, too, for making, like, podcasts a new, like... There's people who are now listening to podcasts who never did before because of Serial.
Absolutely right.
And I hope that... I'm all for everybody succeeding at this point. You know, when everybody has, and when every Tom, Dick, and Harry has a podcast, then fuck you guys. But, but in right the meantime.
Now. Yeah. And Serial is one you should download and listen, unlike ours, which is just downloaded.
Yeah, just download it. Just like the numbers. I just like looking at the feed burner and being like, ooh, people like us.
Hey, hey.
To an extent.
Yeah.
You can find O The Anthem at otheanthem.com, Corey at otheanthem.com, O The Anthem on Facebook, Twitter, Google Plus, YouTube, Vimeo, and the listener line, 443-219-7595.
What's that number again?
443-219-7595.
And you can find me online at all your social networks, Twitter, Tumblr, Instagram, Facebook, at Robert N. Cheek, and adeaddrop.com, foundingthefuture.us. Check out all the blog entries there. Check out all your news on adeaddrop.com.
Buy Rob's book.
Buy my book, Amazon, ebook, or in paper. Both of those links you can find on the website.
I actually touched the paperback copy, and nice, it felt right? nice. It was like real dead trees.
Yes, indeed. And that's themovement.com. But so this is, as always, although it sounded like the Serial podcast, this is the Anthem podcast. For Corey, this is Rob. Oh, wait, shit. I'm fucking the whole thing up. Okay, so, as always, you're listening to the O The Anthem podcast, part of the O The Anthem digital network. For Corey, this is Rob.
I'm going
to
give you, by the way, a link to a song.
Yeah.
Where they did a mashup of Miley Cyrus on top of the Serial theme song.
Right.
And it's so fucking enchanting.
I bet so.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't like Miley Cyrus, but I found it interesting.
But that particular one. Yeah. All right, so for Corey.
Sorry, I interrupted you.
Wait, what's her name? What's the Serial girl's name?
Sarah.
Sarah what? Koenig?
Koenig.
So for Corey and for Sarah Koenig and for myself, this is Rob. Have a great week, everybody.
Thanks for podcasting with us.
Buy my book!
So there you have it, episode 36 of the O The Anthem podcast. Make sure you check out Serial's final episode coming up on this Thursday. Make sure that you listen, not just download. Before you go, check out A Chance Encounter in Cyberspace, one of the Genesis series movies for O The Anthem, and our full episode from last week. Make sure you like and subscribe so you get all the new information as soon as you can. Check us out on Facebook and all over the web. Other than that, have a great week, everybody.